Hello, my name is Christopher, and I have the pleasure of beginning this presentation in our paper, titled Machine Unlearning. Later, you'll hear from my fellow co-authors, Baiwu, Henry, and Luca. Let's begin by quickly going over a few motivating observations that we had on machine learning. Our first observation is that machine learning models are rapidly growing in their number of parameters. Observing this graph, the x-axis shows the model computations, or the prediction efficiency, and the y-axis the model accuracy. These can be roughly correlated with the model size in terms of the number of parameters, shown as the size of the circle. Models now have many millions of parameters, often exceeding the size of the dataset that they are trained on. This overparameterization, combined with the incremental and random nature of stochastic gradient descent, can lead to unintended behaviors and privacy concerns, such as the memorization of data. In particular, it makes it difficult to determine the exact influence of a data point on these parameters. Thus, our first observation is that there is a complex interplay between the data and the learned model parameters. Recently, many new privacy legislation call for more clarity around data privacy. Users are now empowered to remove their data, which impacts machine learning as the model may have already memorized some or all of the data's contributions during training. Much of these legislation come at a time when tech experts and companies are not ready to facilitate the requirements. All of this points to a disconnect between the needs of the people, imposed through legal experts, and what technology experts can provide. Our observations are that there is a lacking synergy between legal and tech experts, and that there's a complex interplay between data and the learned parameters. This creates a concrete problem. How do we unlearn from already trained machine learning models, such as deep neural networks, so that a removal guarantee is easy to comprehend? Let us now define the problem of machine unlearning. Say that we have some data, and we train a model on it. With some randomness, we may learn a different model after training, giving us a distribution of possible models. After getting some more data, shown in blue, we train a new model on the aggregate of all of our data. Imagine the owners of the blue data now request for unlearning. Our goal is to then unlearn from this model so that the unlearned model is equivalent to what we would have obtained without ever training on that data point in the first place. Because of random reinitialization, our unlearned model may be different. Concretely, we need the distribution of possible models after unlearning to be equivalent to those randomly initialized and trained without the unlearned data.
We now turn to solutions for machine unlearning. There are two major solutions in prior works. The first is differentially private learning. In this case, we train a model so that its predictions do not strongly depend on the data. However, to achieve complete unlearning in this case, we require our differential private parameter epsilon to be zero. This prevents learning. The second solution is statistical query learning of Cao et al. Statistical query learning is a formulation where a model learns by asking aggregated queries. However, this solution only works for simple models like naive Bayes and do not apply to more complex models like deep neural networks. They can also only handle a limited number of queries. Given the drawback of solutions from prior works, we take a step back to reconsider the naive solution of machine learning. Namely, first remove the data points we want to unlearn from the dataset, and then retrain the model from scratch with a new dataset. This solution is simple and intuitive, and works for all kinds of models, including deep neural networks. However, it is extremely slow due to retraining on the full dataset. In this work, we aim to improve on the computational efficiency of this naive solution. We propose sharded, isolated, sliced, and aggregated training, also known as SISA. Imagine we have a large dataset D. The first step of SISA is to split this dataset into S shards. This will result in S non-overlapping datasets. Then we train a separate model on each shard in isolation. Thus, each model only sees one shard of data, reducing its data dependency scope. The final model outputs an aggregate of each model's prediction, like an ensemble. This helps recover accuracy loss in sharding. To further optimize retraining time, we introduce slicing during model training. The idea works as follows. Normally, each epoch of stochastic gradient descent will pass over the whole dataset. Instead, we slice the shard prior to the training and incrementally train on more slices as training progresses. Imagine we have R slices in a shard. We train only on the first slice for some number of epochs, we then immediately save its checkpoint. Then we train on the first and second slice, save its checkpoint, and so on. And finally, we train on all R slices and save its checkpoints. This means that when we unlearn, we can leverage past saved model checkpoints depending on where the data was seen. To unlearn the red data point shown in the figure, we only need to retrain one model on the bottom portion of one shard. With SISA, we can achieve at least S times speedup for unlearning any data point, where S is the number of shards. In SISA training scheme, there are three hyperparameters that we can tune to achieve desired unlearning performance. First, if the number of shards is increased, we can have higher speed up for unlearning with a cost of lower accuracy. Second, if we have more slices in each shard, we can also obtain faster retraining speed during unlearning by requiring more storage space for checkpoints. And third, we can swap in different aggregation strategies for better performance. We outline four advantages of SISA. First, SISA is generally applicable to all kinds of models, including statistical models and deep learning models. Second, SISA offers an intuitive definition of unlearning of any data point. SISA also provides provable and auditable way to unlearn data points from machine learning models for either the data owner or the regulator. On the other side, having multiple models trained with disjointed dataset in SISA may cause models to disagree with each other and subsequently reduce its overall accuracy. Each model in SISA is also a weak learner, which may not perform well on complex tasks or even overfit the small shard of training data. We now turn to evaluation.
First, let me describe the experimental setup. For now, we assume the unlearning requests are uniformly distributed across shards and slices, and later on, we relax this assumption. The experiments are done on six datasets, including unlearning from three easy tasks like purchase and SVHN, and three hard ones such as ImageNet. A key aspect of our evaluation is how we evaluate time, which is the main notion of interest for unlearning. In this section, if not specified, we'll be using analytical time to report our results, which is defined to be number of samples in the training dataset. The reason of doing so is that when we evaluate the proposed method, we distribute the training to multiple machines. The work clock time is highly dependent on the hardware, so it becomes challenging for us to log the time consistently. We made an observation here that if the same hardware is used, work clock training time is linear to the number of samples in the training set, as shown in the figure. The measurements are obtained on increments of 10% of the dataset size, and the experiment is repeated 5 times, and we plot the mean and the variance, which is too small to be seen. As mentioned earlier, SISA stands for Sharded, Isolated, Sliced, and Aggregated. So let me start by describing the impact of sharding on accuracy and retraining time. We divide the whole dataset into S shards. Depending on the number of unlearning requests, these requests will fall in one or more of the shards, and we will have to retrain all corresponding models of the ensemble. In experiments, we measure the validation accuracy and analytical retraining time with respect to different number of unlearning requests. To compare the performance, we also introduce two baselines. The first one is called batch k, in which there is only one model trained on the whole dataset. We wait until there is k unlearning requests, and then retrain the model with these k samples removed. The second baseline is called 1 over s fraction. Here we also split the whole dataset into s shards, but only train the model on one of the shards. Then for each unlearning request, there are two possible cases. First, it happens in the shard that we use to retrain the model. In this case, we will need to retrain the model. In the other case, the request happens in a shard that is not used for training, then we don't need to do anything about it. We present our results to answer the following questions. Does increasing number of shards improve retraining speedups? And by doing so, when does accuracy degrade too much? In the figure, we plot retraining time, accuracy, and number of unlearning requests. For SVHN, each curve represents one unlearning method. The black curve is the batch k baseline. Then there are three curves for SISA and 1 over s fraction baseline respectively, each with a different value of s. It can be seen that the batch k baseline has the best accuracy since it uses the entire dataset together, but it's also the slowest one. On the other hand, the 1 over s fraction baseline is very fast to retrain, but the degrading accuracy is significant. Compared to the two baselines, SISA provides a better trade-off. It is faster to retrain than batch k, and has better accuracy than 1 over s. Also, as you can see, the speedup exists as long as the number of unlearning requests is smaller than 3 times the number of shards. The trend discussed holds for other datasets as well.
We now turn to evaluate the slicing procedure. Recall that in the slicing setting, at each step, we reuse the model learned of the previous slices in a recurrent manner. We fine-tune it on the union of the previous slices and the new slice to obtain a new checkpoint that is the starting point of the following step. This has consequences on how the requests are handled. Whenever a request hits a specific slice, we need to retrain from that slice onward, as all the following models are affected. As training with few slices is faster than training with a whole data set, we adapt the number of epochs to the number of slices we use in order to ensure that the model is trained for the same amount of time as it would without slicing. We study the impact of slicing first by measuring the experimental accuracy with respect to the number of epochs, and second, by computing the analytical returning time in conjunction with sharding. To illustrate the impact of slicing on the accuracy, we present a graph of the accuracy with respect to the number of training epochs for the SVHN dataset. We first notice that slice models apparently take more epochs to converge as the number of slices increases, but this is actually an artifact due to the adaptation of the training procedure described earlier. Besides, it turns out there is no degradation of the accuracy attributable to the slicing procedure after sufficient training. Results for the dataset, such as purchase, displayed on the right, are comparable. We now turn to the impact of slicing in terms of returning time. We are especially interested in knowing what is the interplay between sharding and slicing. In the experiment that follows, we focus on the sequential setting, which means requests are processed one by one. We represent the speedup, vertical axis, obtained by both sharding, bottom right axis, and slicing, bottom left axis, in a 3D plot for the SVHN dataset. As we saw earlier in the talk, sharding provides a steadily improving speedup as we add more shards. Conversely, slicing shows a saturating behavior after a certain amount of slices. Increasing the number of slices thus has diminishing returns beyond a few slices. We observe similar phenomena with other datasets. Slicing provides an additional 1.5 times speedup with respect to sharding in the best case, in other words, when saturating. The effect seems magnified for higher number of shards as the speedup is already significant. The choice of an aggregation strategy also has a significant impact on the accuracy of sharding. Our experiments indicate that we can obtain a consistently significant accuracy boost by using an aggregation strategy over the logits instead of the naive majority vote over the labels. You may learn more about this by reading our paper.
We now ask the question, can SISA do even better in terms of retraining efficiency if we have a priori knowledge of a user's probability to request for unlearning? The service provider could likely ascertain the required information from auxiliary data, for instance, how they use the data, what the local perception of that data use is, and if they've had any prior data misuse incidents. Now, imagine we have two types of users, with ground truth data that one group is likely to unlearn, and the other being unlikely to unlearn. Our prior SISA sharding strategy is uniform, so we ignore this information and assume they're all equally likely to unlearn. The image to the right shows a sample sharding of the user data. Because the data from likely-to-learn users are spread uniformly, we have a higher probability of hitting more shards, thus reducing the efficiency gains. But an adaptive SISA approach can take estimates of the ground truth probability and put likely-to-unlearn data into a minimal number of shards. Then, whether the data is unlearned in a stream or a batch, fewer shards are affected, improving SISA efficiency further. We generalize this approach as distribution-aware sharding. Our goal is twofold: to maximize shard size so as to improve model accuracy, but to minimize the chance that a shard, or group of users, has an unlearning request. These goals are in direct opposition, so to find a good middle ground, we will assume that each user requesting for unlearning is an independent Bernoulli trial, akin to a weighted coin flip. This means that we have some probability P, potentially different for each user, that they will request unlearning in a given time interval. With each user having a different probability of unlearning, it becomes difficult to calculate the chance that anyone from the group will unlearn. Our key insight is that if each user is a Bernoulli trial, then the distribution over the group follows a Poisson binomial distribution. We can now calculate the expected chance that any user unlearns in our time period, and the calculation is quite simple. It's the average probability across all users. If we assume one time period for n, then we can ignore it. Using this, the distribution-aware sharding approach is as follows. Add users to the group, represented by chi sub I, until its expectation hits some constant c. The smaller c is, the less chance that that shard will need unlearning, but also the smaller its size, reducing the model accuracy. We implemented the distribution-aware sharding approach on a synthetic dataset modeled from unlearning requests for search engines under the right to be forgotten. The x-axis of this figure shows a stream of unlearning requests, and the y-axis the analytical retraining time. The top line is our benchmark, the uniform SISA strategy, and the bottom line is our distribution-aware sharding approach using the Poisson binomial distribution. There are two major insights. The adaptive strategy is never worse, and it on average reduces the analytical retraining time, as desired. Our takeaways are that SISA provides a guaranteed improvable unlearning strategy that is easy to understand by non-experts. It reduces retraining time consistently with minimal overhead in both storage and training algorithm changes. Further, it is applicable to any model trained by gradient descent, and we can leverage knowledge of the distribution of unlearning requests to further improve unlearning efficiency. Thank you. We're happy to accept any of your questions.